Mitchell Beasley presents The World Atlas of Coffee. From beans to brewing, coffee is explored, explained, and enjoyed. Written and read by James Hoffmann. Introduction. Coffee has never been better than it is today. Producers know more than ever before about growing coffee and have access to more varieties and specialist growing techniques. Coffee roasters have never been so likely to appreciate the importance of using freshly harvested coffee beans, and their understanding of the roasting process continues to improve. There are now more and more cafes selling really good coffee, using the best equipment and training their staff more effectively. I wrote these words in the introduction to the first edition of this book, and they're still true today. The world of great coffee has now gone truly mainstream. Every major city in the world has a plethora of cafes and coffee businesses, all run by passionate people working hard to share something exciting and delightful about coffee. The coffee industry is enormous and has spread around the world. Today, 125 million people depend on coffee production for their livelihood, and coffee is consumed in every part of the globe. Coffee is entwined with both the economic and cultural histories of so many countries, yet very few coffee drinkers have, in the past, scratched the surface to see what is underneath. Yet while many people may not have explored the world of coffee, a large portion of coffee drinkers are seeking out coffee that has been carefully sourced, sold traceably, and brewed with skill and care. The coffee industry can be separated into two distinct areas, commodity and specialty. In this book, we will primarily be dealing with specialty coffees. These are coffees that are defined by their quality and by how good they taste. Their origin is important, as this will often determine the flavor. Commodity coffee is the term used to describe coffees that are not traded on their quality, but are simply considered to be coffee. Where they are grown doesn't matter much, nor when they were harvested or how they were processed. Commodity coffee has defined the way that much of the world thinks about coffee. A generic product from somewhere tropical, an efficient, if bitter, way to get caffeine into the bloodstream and to clear the mind in the morning. The idea that one might drink coffee for pleasure, to delight in its complexity of flavor, still has relatively little penetration into the global culture. There are many differences between the production and international trade of specialty coffees and commodity coffees, as they are quite different products. While this new world of coffee has boomed, it can still be a little intimidating. The language of coffee is foreign to most people, and many cafes are eager to share the story of the coffee they brew, its variety, its post-harvest processing, or the people behind it. This can be overwhelming or frustrating. This book is written to make sense of that language, to give context to the stories of the cups of coffee you drink, to highlight what makes each farm or cooperative different and interesting. At first, the sheer diversity of coffees and the huge volume of information can be off-putting. However, once you start to understand a little about coffee, the diversity and information are the very things that make it so compelling. I hope this book serves you well and brings you a little more pleasure to every cup of coffee you drink. Part 1. Introduction to Coffee. Arabica and Robusta. When talking about coffee, people are usually referring to the fruit from one particular species of the tree, Coffea arabica. Arabica makes up most of the coffee produced each year, and it's grown in dozens of countries between the Tropic of Capricorn and the Tropic of Cancer. It isn't the only species of coffee, however. In fact, over 120 different species of coffee have been identified to date, but only one other is grown in any quantity, and this is Coffea conifera, a plant we commonly refer to as Robusta. Robusta is actually something of a brand name given to the species, chosen to highlight its attributes. It was discovered in the Belgian Congo, what is now the Democratic Republic of the Congo, in the late 19th century, and its commercial potential was clear. It was able to grow and fruit at lower altitudes than existing Arabica plants, in higher temperatures, and was more resistant to disease. These attributes are still what drive much of the production of Robusta today, and because of the way it is grown, it is substantially cheaper to produce. There is an inevitable downside, however. It doesn't taste very good. Some people will make a rather specious argument that a really well-produced Robusta coffee can taste better than a poor Arabica coffee. And this may be true, but it does nothing to convince us that Robusta actually tastes good. It is generally difficult to ascribe particular tastes to coffees, but I think it would be fair to say that Robusta has a woody, burnt rubber quality in the cup. It usually has very little acidity, but will have a heavy body and mouthfeel. There are, of course, grades of quality within Robusta, and it is possible to produce higher quality Robustas. It has been a staple of Italian espresso culture for many years, but currently most of the Robusta produced around the world ends up in large manufacturing plants destined to become the pariah of our industry, instant soluble coffee. For the soluble coffee industry, price is far more important than flavor, and the global reliance on coffee as a fast food product means that Robusta makes up around 40% of the world's coffee produced each year. This percentage is somewhat variable, driven by the fluctuations in price and demand. For example, an increase in the global price of coffee may result in more Robusta production, as large multinational coffee companies may need to find cheaper alternatives to Arabica. Interestingly, in the past, when roasters have substituted Robusta coffees for Arabica in big commercial blends, there has been a downward trend in coffee consumption. This might be related to flavor or to the fact that Robusta has about twice the caffeine content of Arabica. Either way, when big brands cut corners, consumers notice, or at least change their coffee drinking habits. The genetics of coffee. The coffee industry treated Robusta like an ugly sister to Arabica until a rather interesting genetic discovery was made. Once scientists began sequencing the genes, it became clear that the two species are not cousins or siblings. Instead, it appears that Robusta is, in fact, a parent of Arabica. Most likely, somewhere in southern Sudan, Robusta crossed with another species called Coffea eugenoides and produced Arabica. This new species spread and really began to flourish in Ethiopia, long considered to be the birthplace of coffee. Currently, 129 species of Coffea have been identified, mostly through the work of Kew Gardens in London, though most look very different to the plants and beans we are familiar with. Many of these species are indigenous to Madagascar, though others grow in parts of southern Asia and as far south as Australia. None of these species has any commercial attention at the moment, but scientists are beginning to show more interest in them because of a concern facing the coffee industry, the lack of genetic diversity of the plants currently in cultivation. The way that coffee has spread around the world means that we have a global crop with a common ancestry. There is very little variation in the genetic makeup of coffee plants, and this exposes global coffee production to massive risk. A disease that can attack one plant can likely attack them all, something the wine industry suffered with phylloxera, an aphid that devastated huge swathes of grapevines across Europe in the 1860s and 1870s. The coffee tree. This section deals only with the most interesting of the coffee species, Coffea arabica. At first glance, all Arabica trees look similar, a thin trunk with numerous branches coming off it, supporting foliage and fruit. However, if you look closer, there are many differences between trees determined by the variety of Arabica being grown. Different varieties yield different amounts of fruit, in different colors, and some carry the fruit in clusters, while others have fruit evenly spaced down the branch. There are also big differences between the leaves of plants of different varieties, but more importantly between the cup characteristics when the seeds of these varieties are harvested and brewed. Different varieties have different qualities of flavor and may also have different mouthfeels. It is always important to remember that for the bulk of coffee producers, flavor is not the main reason they have selected a certain variety to grow. The yield of the tree and its resistance to disease are usually of great value to those who depend on coffee growing for their livelihood. That is not to say that all producers choose their varieties this way, but one should bear in mind the impact of these choices on the profitability and income of the producer. From seed to tree. Most established coffee farms have a nursery in which to raise seedlings before planting them out on the farm for production. The coffee beans are first planted in rich soil and will soon germinate. The bean itself is lifted out of the ground by the developing shoot, and at this stage they are often called soldiers. They look strangely like a roasted coffee bean has been attached to the top of a thin green stem. Not long after this, the bean bursts open to reveal the first leaves. Coffee plants grow quickly, and after 6 to 12 months they can be moved from the nursery into production. Coffee growing requires the investment of not only money, but also time. A coffee farmer will usually have to wait 3 years for a newly planted tree to fruit properly. Making the decision to begin growing coffee is a serious one, and this also means that if a producer abandons coffee, it will be difficult to encourage them to return to the crop in the future. Blossom and fruit. Most coffee trees have one main harvest per year, though the trees in some countries have a second harvest, which is usually smaller and of a slightly lower quality. The cycle is first triggered by a prolonged period of rainfall. This causes the trees to bloom, producing lots of white blossom flowers with a strong scent that is reminiscent of jasmine. Insects such as bees pollinate the flowers, although Arabica is able to self-pollinate, meaning that unless they are knocked off the tree by adverse weather, the flowers will always yield fruit. It takes up to 9 months until the fruits are ready to harvest. Unfortunately, coffee cherries do not ripen uniformly. The coffee producer has a difficult choice between harvesting all the fruit from each tree at the same time and having a certain quantity of unripe or overripe coffee cherries in the harvest, or paying pickers to do multiple passes of the same trees so each cherry is harvested when it is perfectly ripe. Pests and diseases. The coffee tree is susceptible to a variety of pests and diseases. Two of the most common are coffee leaf rust and the coffee berry borer. Coffee leaf rust. Known as roya in many countries, this is a fungus, Hemileia vastatrix, that causes orange lesions on the leaves. It impairs photosynthesis and causes the leaves to drop and eventually can kill the tree. It was first documented in East Africa in 1861, although it was not studied until it began to affect plants in Sri Lanka in 1869, where it pretty much destroyed the coffee plantations over the following 10 years. It spread to Brazil in 1970, perhaps brought over from Africa with a shipment of cacao seeds, and quickly spread into Central America. It is now found in every coffee-producing country in the world, and the higher temperatures brought about through climate change are exacerbating the situation. In 2013, several Central American countries declared a state of emergency due to the damage caused by rust. Coffee berry borer, also known widely as brocca. This is a small beetle, Hippothenamus hampei, that lays its eggs inside coffee cherries. The hatching young eat the cherries, thereby reducing the quantity and quality of the crop. The beetle is native to Africa, although it is now the most harmful pest to coffee crops around the world. Research is being done into different methods of control, including chemical pesticides, traps, and biological controls. The coffee fruit. Coffee is a part of our everyday lives, yet how many of us outside the coffee-producing countries have ever seen or would even recognize a coffee cherry? The size of the fruit varies between the varieties of coffee, but on the whole, they are the size of a small grape. Unlike grapes, most of the volume of the fruit is provided by the central seeds, although there is a thin layer of fruit flesh under the skin. All cherries start out green and develop deeper colors as the fruit matures. The skin is usually a deep red when ripe, though some trees have yellow fruit, and occasionally a cross between a yellow fruiting tree and a red fruiting tree will yield orange fruit. While fruit color isn't thought to influence yield, yellow fruiting trees have often been avoided as it's harder to determine when the fruit is ripe. Red fruit starts green, goes through a yellow stage, and then turns red. This makes ripeness much easier to identify when the coffee is being picked by hand. Ripeness is tied to the quantity of sugar in the fruit, which is vitally important when trying to grow delicious coffee. Generally speaking, the more sugar in the fruit, the better. However, different producers harvest their cherries at different stages of ripeness. Some believe that a mixture of cherries at different stages of ripeness can add complexity to a coffee, though all cherries should be properly ripe and none of them overripe, as they eventually develop an unpleasant flavor. Sweet fruits. The flesh of the coffee fruit is surprisingly delicious when ripe, a pleasing honeydew melon sweetness with a little refreshing acidity. The fruits are sometimes squeezed to make a drink, but even when ripe, they are not particularly juicy, and you have to work to separate the flesh from the seeds. The seed. The seed, or coffee bean, is made up of several layers, most of which will be removed during processing, leaving behind the bean we grind and brew. The seed has a protective outer layer, called the parchment, then a thinner layer wrapped around it, called the silver skin. Most coffee cherries contain two seeds, which face each other inside the berry, becoming flattened along one side as they develop. Occasionally, only one seed inside a berry will germinate and grow, and these are known as pea berries. Instead of having a flattened surface on one side, these seeds are rounded and make up about 5% of the crop. These peaberries are usually separated from the rest of the crop, and some people believe that they have particularly desirable qualities or that they roast in different ways to the flattened beans. Coffee varieties. The first coffee trees to be cultivated originated in Ethiopia, and this same variety, Typica, is still widely grown today. Many other varieties now exist, some natural mutations and others the result of crossbreeding. Some varieties have explicit taste characteristics of their own, while others take their characteristics from the terroir in which they are grown, the way they are cultivated, and the way they are processed after harvest. Few coffee consumers are aware that there are different varieties of the Arabica coffee tree, mainly because much of the world's coffee always has been, and still is, traded by origin. A particular lot may come from many farms and, by the time of export, no one knows which varieties the contributing producers had grown, only which part of the world it was grown in. This is starting to change, but we still know relatively little about how much impact the variety of the tree can have on the taste of the cup of coffee. Please note that the descriptions of the most common varieties will not include any specific notes on taste unless there is something definite and distinct. So many factors influence cup quality, and coupled with the lack of organized research on the way that this can be influenced by variety, it would be misleading to make any bold claims. Varieties and varietals. There is often some confusion over the term variety and varietal. Varieties are genetically distinct variations of a single species, in this case, Café Arabica, that may show different characteristics in the tree structure, leaves, or fruit. Cultivar is another acceptable term to use here, as this is just a truncation of cultivated variety. Varietal should be used when referring to a specific instance of a variety. When referring to the production of one farm, for example, it would be correct to say that it was 100% Bourbon varietal. Typica. This is considered the original variety from which all other varieties have mutated or been genetically selected. The Dutch were the first to spread coffee around the world for commercial production, and this was the variety they took with them. The fruit is usually red, and Typica is capable of producing excellent cup quality, though with relatively small yield compared to other varieties. It is still grown extensively in many different parts of the world and, as a result, is known by several different names including Criollo, Sumatra, and Arabigo. Bourbon. This was a natural mutation of Typica which occurred on the island of Reunion, at the time called Bourbon. The yield is higher than that of Typica, and many in the specialty industry believe that it has a distinctive sweetness, making it prized and desirable. There are various variations in the colour of the fruit, red, yellow, and occasionally orange. This variety was grown very widely in the past, but in many producing countries it was replaced by higher yielding varieties. This was at a time when the market had not yet matured sufficiently to reward a high enough price to compensate for the lower yields it produces compared to newer varieties. Mundo Novo. A natural hybrid of Typica and Bourbon, this variety was named after the place in Brazil where it was discovered in the 1940s. It is grown for its relatively high yield, strength, and disease resistance, and also for its success at altitudes of around 1,000 to 1,200 meters, 3,300 to 3,900 feet, which are common in Brazil. Catura. This is a mutation of Bourbon discovered in Brazil in 1937. Its yields are relatively high, though it has the capacity for overbearing, where the tree produces more fruit than it can sustain and succumbs to dieback. However, good farm management can avoid this situation. This variety has been especially popular in Colombia and Central America, though it is still fairly common in Brazil. Cup quality is considered good, and while quality increases with altitude, yield decreases. There are both red and yellow variations, and it is a low-growing variety, often referred to as dwarf or semi-dwarf, popular because they are easier to pick by hand. Catuai. This is a hybrid between Catura and Mundo Novo, created by the Instituto Agronomico de Campinas in Brazil in the 1950s and 60s. It was selected as it combined the dwarf characteristics of Catura with the yield and strength of Mundo Novo. Like Catura, there are red and yellow varieties. Maragohipe. One of the most easily recognized varieties, Maragohipe is a mutation of Typica, first discovered in Brazil. It is notable, and often considered desirable, due to the unusually large size of its beans. The tree also has exceptionally large leaves, but a relatively low yield. This coffee is often referred to as elephant or elephant bean coffee due to its size. The fruits usually ripen red. SL28. A now prized variety, SL28 was created in Kenya by Scott Laboratories in the 1930s, selected from a drought-resistant variety from Tanzania. The fruits are red when ripe and the beans are notably larger than average. This variety is considered to be capable of producing a cup with distinct fruit flavor, often described as blackcurrant. It is quite susceptible to coffee leaf rust and performs better at higher altitudes. SL34. This variety was selected from French Mission Bourbon, a variety brought back to Africa from Bourbon, Reunion, and first appearing in Tanzania and then in Kenya. It is also capable of distinct fruit flavors, but is generally considered to be inferior to SL28 in cup quality. It is also susceptible to coffee leaf rust, and the fruits ripen red. Geisha or Geisha. There is some debate over the correct name for this variety, though Geisha is more commonly used. Geisha is a tan in western Ethiopia, and while the variety was brought to Panama from Costa Rica, it is believed to be Ethiopian in origin. The variety is considered to produce exceptionally aromatic floral cups, and the demand for it has driven up prices in recent years. It has gained prominence and popularity dramatically since 2004 when one Panamanian farm, Hacienda La Esmeralda, entered a competition with a geisha lot. The coffee proved so unusual and distinct that it attracted an unusually high bid of $21 per pound at auction. This record bid was beaten in 2006 and 2007, reaching $130 per pound, nearly 100 times more than a commodity-grade coffee. This has since encouraged many producers in Central and South America to plant this variety. Pacas. Pacas is a natural mutation of Bourbon, discovered in El Salvador in 1949 by the Pacas family. It has red fruits, and its low-growing habit makes picking easy. Its cup quality is considered similar to Bourbon and is therefore desirable. Villa Sachi. Named after the town in Costa Rica where it was discovered, this is another natural mutation of Bourbon that, like Pacas, exhibits dwarfism. It is currently being bred to produce very high yields and is capable of excellent cup quality. The fruits ripen red. Pacamara. This is a cross between the Pacas and Maragohipe varieties created in El Salvador in 1958. Like Maragohipe, it has extremely large leaves, fruit, and coffee beans. It also has distinct cup characteristics that can be positively described. It can taste like chocolate and fruit, but it also has the capacity for unpleasantly herbal, onion-like cups. The fruits ripen red. Kent. Named after a planter who worked on a selection program in India in the 1920s, this variety was developed for its resistance to coffee leaf rust, though it can be destroyed by new strains of the disease. S795. Also developed in India, this is a cross between Kent and S288, an older selection resistant to coffee leaf rust. It is now widely planted in India and Indonesia, although it is now considered to have lost much of its resistance. Wild Arabica varieties. Most of the above varieties are genetically extremely similar, as they all stem from one variety, Typica. Many of the coffee trees grown in Ethiopia, however, are not selected cultivars, but are indigenous heirloom varieties that probably result from crossbreeding between different species as well as different varieties. Little work has been done so far to catalogue or explore the genetic diversity and cup quality of these wild varieties. Harvesting coffee. Careful harvesting of coffee cherries is fundamentally important to the quality of the resulting cup of coffee. Unsurprisingly, coffee beans harvested from fruit at peak ripeness generally taste the best. Many experts see the harvest as the point at which the quality of the coffee peaks, and every stage thereafter is about preserving quality rather than improving it. The greatest challenge in harvesting high-quality coffee is perhaps the topography of the land on which the coffee is growing. Great coffee requires altitude, and many coffee farms are located on steep slopes in mountainous areas. Simply navigating between the trees can be difficult, if not downright dangerous. This isn't true of every coffee farm, however. Machine harvesting. Brazil has large areas of flat land at high altitude where coffee proliferates. The estates in these areas drive large machines down the neat rows of coffee trees to harvest the cherries. These machines essentially shake the tree until the fruit comes loose. There are numerous downsides to machine harvesting, the biggest being the issue of collecting fruit before it is necessarily ripe. The cherries on the branch of a coffee tree ripen at different rates, so each branch has both ripe and unripe cherries together. The machines do not differentiate and pick all the cherries at once. This means they must be sorted after harvest to separate the ripe from the unripe and to discard the twigs and leaves that also get shaken off the tree. The cost of the coffee's production will be lower than any other harvesting method, but at the expense of the quality of the harvest as a whole. Strip picking. A great deal of coffee is still harvested by hand, as machines simply cannot operate in hilly areas. One of the faster methods of hand picking is to strip all the cherries off a branch together with one deft movement. Like machine harvesting, this is a quick but imprecise way to pick the cherries. It doesn't require expensive equipment or flat land, but still results in a mixed bag of ripe and unripe cherries that must be sorted later. Hand picking. For high-quality coffee, hand picking remains the most effective way of harvesting. Pickers select only the cherries that are ready for harvest, leaving the unripe fruit on the tree to be picked later. This is hard labor, and producers face the challenge of incentivizing their pickers to only harvest the ripe fruit. Pickers are paid by the weight of the fruit they pick, which encourages them to pick unripe fruit to make up additional weight. Quality-conscious producers have to work carefully with their picking teams to make sure they are also paid for uniform ripeness. The problems of labor. The cost of hand-picking coffee is proving a growing challenge and contributes a large part of the production costs. This is one of the primary reasons that coffees produced in developing economies, such as Kona coffees produced in Hawaii, are so expensive. In rapidly developing countries, people simply don't want to pick coffee for a living. Coffee farms in Central America often employ itinerant pickers who travel from country to country as different regions harvest at slightly different times. Currently, many of these workers are from Nicaragua, as it is the weakest economy in the region. Finding people to harvest coffee is likely to continue to be a challenge, and in fact, at one stage, Puerto Rico was using its prisoners to harvest coffee. Sorting the beans. After picking, the cherries are often sorted using a variety of different methods to prevent unripe or overripe coffee from joining the bulk of the lot. In parts of the world with relatively low labor costs and little money available for investment in equipment, this is done by hand. In more developed countries, the cherries are often sorted using a flotation tank. The cherries are poured into a large tank of water where the ripe fruit sinks to the bottom. They are pumped from there into the main processing section. Unripe fruit floats to the top and is skimmed off to be processed separately. Fallen fruit. Coffee growers collect any fruit that naturally falls off the trees, ripe or not. This is usually collected separately and will become part of the lower quality lots that even the best farms in the world inevitably produce. Leaving fallen fruit on the ground under the trees can cause problems as they tend to attract pests, such as coffee berry borer. Processing. How a coffee is processed after harvest can have a dramatic effect on the resulting cup, so it has become an increasingly important part of how it is described and sold. It would be a mistake to believe that coffee producers have flavor in mind when they are choosing their processing methods. A very small percentage do, but for most producers, the goal is to ensure the processing causes the least possible incidences of defect and can cause no drop in the quality and thus the monetary value of the coffee. After harvest, the coffee cherries are taken to a wet mill to separate the beans from the flesh and dry the beans so they are safe for storage. Coffee beans start with a moisture content of around 60% and should be dried to around 11 to 12% to ensure that they do not rot while waiting to be sold and shipped. A wet mill can be anything from a small collection of equipment on an individual farm to a very large industrialized facility for processing enormous amounts of coffee. The wet mill processes the coffee from the cherry stage to the parchment stage, when the bean is dry but still covered with its layer of parchment or pergamino. Most believe that the coffee is pretty well protected by this outer layer and that it does not really begin to degrade until the coffee is hulled to remove the parchment at the last possible moment before the coffee ships. The term wet milling is slightly misleading, as some producers use very little, if any, water in the processing methods they use. It does, however, make the distinction between this initial processing and the later stage when the hulling and grading takes place, known as dry milling. There is no doubt that processing can have a massive impact on the cup quality of the coffee, and there is a growing trend for skilled producers to manipulate the process in order to yield specific qualities in the cup. However, these producers are very rare on the global production scale. The goal of processing for most is to make the coffee as profitable as possible, and this is taken into account when a producer chooses which processing method to use. Some processors require more time, investment, or natural resources than others, and so it is an important decision for any coffee producer. Defining defect. The term defect is used quite specifically in coffee. It is used to describe individual beans that have developed problems that result in bad flavors. Some defects can be spotted by taking a look at the raw coffee, others only come to light when the coffee is tasted. A mild defect might be a bean that has been damaged by insects, and this is easy to spot. A more serious problem is a phenolic coffee, where the coffee has a very harsh metallic paint stripper flavor mixed with notes of sulfur. It's as bad as it sounds. The cause of this defect isn't well understood yet. Bad processing can also cause defects, including giving the coffee a fermented flavor or an unpleasantly dirty, almost boozy quality. It can also add a taste reminiscent of barnyards and rotten fruit. The natural process. Also known as the dry process, this is the oldest method of processing coffee. After harvest, the coffee cherries are spread out in a thin layer to dry in the sun. Some producers spread them out on brick patios. Others use special raised drying beds, which allow better airflow around the cherry, resulting in more even drying. The cherries must be turned regularly to avoid mold, fermentation, or rotting taking place. Once the coffee is properly dry, the outer husk of skin and dried fruit are removed mechanically, and the raw coffee is then stored before export. The natural process itself adds certain flavors to the coffee, sometimes positive, but often quite unpleasant. However, if there is no access to water, this may be the only process open to the producer and is therefore common in places like Ethiopia and also parts of Brazil. Worldwide, the dry method is generally deemed only suitable for very low quality or unripe coffee, and the bulk of coffee produced this way is processed as cheaply as possible, as it usually ends up in the domestic market and has very little value. It seems counterintuitive that a producer would invest in the drying tables necessary for the little return on offer. However, there are those who choose this method to process high-quality coffee, and they often find the process to be more expensive due to the additional labor involved in the attentive, careful drying of the cherries. This process remains quite traditional in places, and there is certainly demand for the cup qualities that a carefully processed lot can have. The process will often add fruit flavors to the coffee, regardless of variety and terroir. These are usually described as hints of blueberry, strawberry, or tropical fruit, but sometimes with negative terms like barnyard, wild, ferment, and manure. High-quality naturals polarize those who work in coffee. Many see value in coffees that taste spectacularly fruity and believe they are extremely useful for showcasing the possibilities of flavor that coffee has to offer. Others find the wild flavors unpleasant or have concerns about buyers encouraging producers to process more of their coffee through the natural process. With such an unpredictable process, a high-quality lot could be damaged irreparably and significantly reduce the producer's income. Drying speed and storage potential. While at an early stage, research seems to suggest that drying coffee very slowly and very evenly can have benefits not only to quality in the short term, but also to how long a coffee will retain its good flavor when it's stored in its raw state. Coffees dried too quickly can lose their attractive qualities shortly after being delivered to the roaster, in some cases within a few months or even weeks, which is bad news for both the roaster and the end consumer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.